some noise for 10 years of curious comedy. Now go bananas for our founder and co-artistic director, Stacey Hallal.
And flown around to celebrate 10 years of Curious Comedy, which I built and ran and performed and did everything all by myself, you guys. Thank you for being here to celebrate me, with me, because nobody helps you do shit in this world. And that's what you need to know. If I've learned anything in 10 years, right, Cameron? You've done shit to help this place, Cameron Gable. No, I am so excited to be here. It's very bizarre and surreal to be at the 10-year mark of Curious Comedy Theater. I remember at the 5-year mark feeling like it had gone by super fast, like a blink of the eye, and also like an eternity. And the second 5 years, just the blink of an eye. It's been so fast. There's been so much change, so much growth, so many people, so many just incredible contributions from audience members and performers and the people behind the scenes who I hope and will attempt to acknowledge as well today. So I'm going to talk more than I normally do when I host. It's my day, so fuck y'all. There have been so many people doing so many things, and to start with, I don't know if you guys were watching those photos. So this theater started as a big empty space that we moved into. We had to cut the concrete to run the water and the electricity for the bar and build everything that's in here. And for the first 8 years, it looked very different than it does now. I thought it looked pretty good for what we had, you know? Like, we did pretty well with the resources we had. And we put all the money we had, plus $8,000 of credit card debt, into building the space. I sold a condo in Chicago, I moved here, and everything I had, plus that $8,000, went into building out the space, which means we started Curious Comedy itself with nothing except $8,000 of debt. Which, if you ask a business person, probably not the best way to start a business. I'm just saying, save some money for the business. But it was all we had, and it was just so much work by so many people. And many of those people you will see here tonight. But I do want to acknowledge, to start out, Michelle Reeves, who is one of the most fabulous human beings in the whole world, just so smart, so talented. She is the person who helped us find the space and led me step by step through the whole process of figuring out how to turn an empty box into a theater. And kept, like, when I'd call her up and be like, ah, she'd be like, okay, next step. Let's just do one step at a time, one step at a time. And really held my hand through that whole process. And Tom Ghilarducci, who was the contractor who both designed and built the original space, and did it for a song and a dance. So thanks, Tom. So I just wanted to mention that. I hope you guys were seeing some of those photos. And then the performers that you're gonna see tonight, many of them have been here the whole time, this whole 10 years. And for me, that's one of my proudest things, is still being surrounded by the people who walked in the door full of hope and who believed in this vision when it was nothing and have put up with all the ups and downs and the learning curve. And so we're here to celebrate them tonight. One of them is Katie Behrens. Yeah. Missed the build out. She was smart. She came 6 months in. She's laughing the hardest back there. But to make up for it, I think she has performed in more shows than I have here at Curious. I would say Katie is the most time clocked here on the Curious Comedy stage. And Katie Michels will be doing a set with her shortly. And Katie Michels came a little bit later, but she came in with some HR experience and some theater experience and was like, Stacey, let's get some shit in order and really help put things on track. And it was a joy and a pleasure to get to see her face and work with her every single day. So I'm going to stop talking for now because, ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to Katie! Okay, I'll play with you.
Okay. Can we please get a suggestion for a location that may fit on the stage, which is now big? What?
Basement.
Tim Hortons. Thank you. Hey, Samantha. How's it going?
Fine.
The usual?
Yeah, the usual. It's 7:30, and I'm awake.
I know, Samantha, and you know what? We are just honored to have you work here, okay?
Thank you, Brittany. This is all...
Thank you. Brittany! No.
How do you do it?
Trip over the rug every day? I don't know. Honestly, we gotta get it fixed. It's a little bump and...
You're always smiling and chipper, and it's 7:30 a.m.
Yeah, it is.
Have you thought about that?
Honestly, I try not to think about it, you know? I just try and think about the coffee and the donuts and you. Samantha, you're my hero. You know, you opened up this franchise with not a dollar in your bank account.
I got to $8,000 of credit card debt.
And you know what a business person would have said about that? Save some money for the business! But screw them! What's a 401k?
Do you know? Because I legitimately don't.
I legitimately do not.
Okay.
I do not.
Thank you for being so chipper every day.
You're welcome.
That and my addiction to caffeine is what gets me awake in the morning.
And your addiction to caffeine gets me awake in the morning because I'm like, if I don't get it ready, she'll be a monster.
Oh, no.
No, I'm sorry. Brittany, I didn't mean it like, I didn't.
Oh, God, please don't cry. Don't. Please, I didn't. I haven't even taken one sip of this yet.
I'm an idiot!
Unhealthy for you. I think you.
No, please don't take this away from me.
No, I think that this is bad. I think I am bad for you. I think that this is a secret, one of those secret undercover toxic relationships.
Samantha, you're the only strong woman in my life, okay? And you really literally built this shop from the ground up when you bought it with credit.
Brittany, I think you should go talk to somebody.
I don't have anyone else but you.
That's what I'm saying.
You want to talk?
Somebody else who may be a little bit more qualified.
Who could possibly be more qualified than you?
Anybody with a college degree.
College is for the birds. That's what my dad used to always say. But he dropped out of middle school, so.
Honestly, it is kind of a racket, but still.
I know.
I'm sorry that I've.
You know what? Today things are gonna change. No.
Okay.
Things are gonna change today, Brittany. I am not gonna drink a cup. I'm not gonna drink a cup of coffee. I will not drink
Samantha.
A cup of coffee. I'm not gonna
Samantha,
drink.
Samantha, your nose is bleeding.
I'll be fine. The air is dry. We're obviously in Canada.
Obviously, where else would you
find a Tim Hortons?
Find a Tim Hortons and people nice enough to give it to you with zero money.
Brittany, I'm not gonna drink coffee, and you're gonna talk to somebody who's not a customer and who's not me. Brittany, your nose is bleeding.
Sorry, I'm late.
I was expecting you to be. So it's fine.
When you do that with your voice, it makes me feel like it's not.
Oh, look who can pick up on context clues now.
Oh, Wanda, you really are a treat. So happy we started this knitting show together.
Yes, it is such a delight to talk about knitting with you, someone who crochets.
It is not one's fault what one's family was one was born into.
No, but one can deny their one's family their one backstory and start changing one's story for itself.
You got me worked up. Said one too many times.
You lost me. The math didn't add up. Don't give me that look.
You just said the word math and I thought about equations.
I know. Oh, you're a regular Einstein.
I sure am. Yeah. You know how much math goes into knitting?
How could I possibly know how much math goes into
All right, you crochet.
One cannot control what one's blood has in it. I will not repeat it.
Yes, but one can get a blood transfusion if one wishes. Or if one is in desperate need for it in order.
One other one may think that if one did get a blood transfusion, one may be a fraud. And one was originally born into a crochet family.
How dare you?
I know a crochet hand when I see it.
No.
The way your fingers curl around the little hook.
No, don't look at my hands.
This show is literally focused on our hands for 2 to 4 hours every day from 2 a.m. to 6 a.m.
Do you watch it?
Yes! How else would I give myself notes?
Fine.
Warm up.
I was going to give you a confession, but now one does not have to give a confession if one feels bullied.
Why would one say one was going to give a confession if one was not going to confess? One's heart would be awfully heavy if one did not get it off its chest.
My mother crocheted.
Wanda?
Yes.
I am flattered you have told me this.
Don't let it get to your head.
It's not.
I respect you. As one who's come from a crochet family, I know how hard it can be to admit that. I remember when I was just a young knitter.
What?
In a school of knitters, and everyone found out I was originally from a crochet family. And they made fun of me. They ridiculed me. They threw needles at me.
Yes, the knitting community can be quite cruel.
They started at a young age. They knitted me to the playset. I was stuck there like Charlotte's web.
I'm sorry that happened to you.
So I can only imagine what torment you're going through now, and I want you to know, as much as I'm reveling at the inside of how humiliating it is for you, I will never knit you to your chair, and I will never share this secret with anyone, except the million viewers who may have seen it, because
we choose to do a live knitting show? What else is there to talk about except secrets while you knit?
Nothing. Honestly, the Norwegian slow TV trend is really killing us. Hello, everyone. Hello.
It's not interactive. It's just live.
I can't figure it out.
That's the crochet in you.
Please. Please.
Yeah, be scared.
I don't know anything, okay? Yeah. I was just in this alley. I was trying to get away from a guy, please.
Yeah, that guy got away from me.
Please,
and
don't.
That was... Are you scared yet?
Honestly, I'm a little comforted by the tone of your voice. Do you want to start over?
Are you scared now? Are you scared now?
I'm sorry, now you sound like a pirate and it's just in an alley so the aesthetics don't match.
I was trying to deny my good.
I'm sorry, are you on that knitting show?
Yes. But I've currently found solace in denying all things about myself that are true. So I'm trying to be a petty criminal.
Me too.
What?
I got fired from the job that I love, from the boss that I love. And she told me I gotta, talk to other people.
Oh.
And,
now, when you say boss that you love, what kind of love is that that you have for this boss?
Well, at first I thought I just really loved giving coffee and donuts to her every morning. But I think it was more than that.
Yes, you give the same person coffee and donuts enough mornings in a row and it turns into something.
Yes. There's something so comforting about knowing when they're going to walk in and that they want a medium cup filled up to a small amount. You know?
Yes, that is an odd bit of information that only an intimate person in their life would know.
And she was just so strong.
Physically or emotionally?
Emotionally.
Oh.
Probably physically, but donuts aren't heavy, so I was never really able to see something like an act of physical strength in that. I mean, she did lift up the counter thing, to get through, but...
If there's one thing I've learned, it's that if you have somebody you see every day for a number of hours, you feel like you know them so completely. Don't let them go. Don't let your show die before you tell them how you feel about them. Don't tell them that the fact that they crochet is the most beautiful thing you ever thought about them.
Your nose is bleeding.
Yes, that's my show!
about this space, Bob Ladwig, and I moved here together from Chicago. I was studying at Second City. I did their directing program. During one of our classes, and we're just going to go back to 2007 right now together, they came out and said, we will never hire a woman to direct our main stage. It got real uncomfortable in here. And I was like, what? And, they'd let us be in the directing program, but they weren't going to hire any women to direct their main stage. And it's been 10 years, and they still have not had a woman direct that main stage. 60 years total at Second City. They do in Toronto, at their Toronto stage, but not in Chicago. And they were like, every cast needs an alpha male, and alpha male will never listen to a woman director. So just how much has changed since 2007? At least you probably wouldn't say that out loud now. I don't know. But we opened in 2008. Obama had just been elected for the first time. Sam Adams had just been elected, which was like, yay, aww. First openly gay mayor of Portland. So that was a good thing. Times have changed a tremendous amount. I also want to acknowledge Catherine Durkin and Jeffrey Kaufman. I'm like nervous because I'm terrified I'm not going to acknowledge somebody. That's how much I want to acknowledge everybody. And David Saffert and Stephanie Cordell, who were here. Give them a round of applause. Scott Rogers, Bree Pruitt, Nathan Loveless, who you're going to see in a moment, Nate Smith, who's here, Jenn Hunter, who's here, literally laid down the floor. All these people, David and Stephanie painted that entire wall. Ashley Smith, who is here, Nate Smith's wife, painted about 90% of what you see here, and hate tights. So she was here every day. So what we would do is the contractor would call me at 7 every morning, tell me what we needed to get ahead on. I'd spend the day running around shopping and finding stuff. They'd finish around 4, and then we'd come in with a crew of volunteers and work from 4 in the evening until I'd stay till 5 in the morning. And then I'd sleep 2 hours, and then the contractor would call at 7. And so everybody was here late and putting in long hours, and it's so amazing that they did that when they barely knew me. I had just moved back. But Nathan Loveless and Nate Smith are the two people who like sat down with me when it was a business plan, and I sat and I went through my little binder like Leslie Knope and explained everything, and they're like, yeah, we're on board. And they are still on board today. Nate still performs here. Constantly, Nathan as well. Nathan's the president of our board. Nathan and Nikki, I married them to each other. They've had 2 babies. Nate Smith's had 2 babies. It's been a long 10 years, you guys. So many things have happened. When you do a crazy thing like run a business with nothing, every now and then you hit a wall, and then the crazy thing happens is these people appear out of nowhere and just fix your life for you, which is amazing. And the first person to do that was Greg Shossi. For those of you who know Greg Shossi, we had a series of bartender debacles when we first opened. I don't know anything about running a bar. And Greg was in class, and one day he goes, I know a little something about a bar. If you need somebody to like do a bar, I could do it. And I was like, yes, I don't know you, but yes, you're all I have. And Greg proceeded to spend the next many years, I don't even know, 8 years, running our bar entirely as his own, world in there. He took it entirely off my plate. He moved in my house, became my best roommate and my brother, and couldn't be here. Came down for the original date of this event. Couldn't come down today. But he was one of those. Beth Lewis came here just when I found out my dad was sick and dying, and she and Katie Michels pretty much ran the theater for the 2 years while I was running back and forth to the East Coast, and she gave us the foundation. She is now running Bag and Baggage, which built a beautiful million-dollar theater in Hillsborough. Go see amazing shows. Her space is incredible. And Rebecca Lingefelter came in prior to Beth and was like my first person who understood books and like accounting, and now is a teacher. She's a professor at Lewis and Clark. So I had her until she got her dream job. If you see the Portland Experimental Theater Ensemble, she runs that as well. She's a genius who worked for us for nothing for a period of time just because she had just moved to town and changed the course of everything here. So there's so many people doing stuff in a little office with like no privacy and no company, and they were just in there like Bob Cratchit, and I was Scrooge. So I just wanted to acknowledge them. So I think this is around our 5-year mark. We did a fundraiser, and I made this video in a hotel room on a work trip for my other job that was actually paying me. It didn't do well for the fundraiser, but I think if an amazing thing about running a venue is like how much stuff happens here and the range of things. We've had community events, we've had weddings, we've had services, we've had like, in addition to all the different kinds of comedy shows. So I just want to play this very short video so you can just kind of see the breadth and of what's happened here and curious and what we've done out elsewhere. Can you play that video? Thank you.
Once upon a time, there was a girl who had a dream. It was a big dream. She wanted to open a nonprofit comedy theater. Why? Good question. Because she believed in the power of comedy to transform people's lives in amazing ways. She soon met some people who shared her dream, and then more and more. And together they created a community. This community brought local people together to laugh, learn, and grow through comedy shows, classes, and community events. They brought talented people from across the country, the continent, and the globe to Portland, Oregon to share their talents, inspiration, and laughter. They used comedy to help kids in underperforming low-income schools learn to read and write with joy and enthusiasm. They used improv to improve the quality of life of seniors living with Alzheimer's disease. And they created a festival to prove that women can do anything. In other words, they did a lot with very little. And to keep going, they need your support. All this work takes money, and the grants they receive only cover a portion of what these programs cost. Please give if you can. Because if everyone gives a little, it becomes a whole lot. For Curious Comedy Theater, for the community of people it serves with all of its heart, and for everyone who believes that dreams really can come true.
I think it's a little haunting, though, isn't it? It's like a little, it's a little creepy, a little creepy. I'm sorry, but it makes me cry every time. Awesome. We're gonna have Whiskey Tang out here in a minute, but first, we have a local businessman who has been very supportive of Curious Comedy Theater, and I promised him, you know, a little time tonight. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Big Ed Barnum.
Thank you, Stacey. Howdy, folks. My name is Big Ed Barnum. I'm the owner and operator of Big Ed Barnum's Bobble Barn and Garden. And I've got a very important message for you. Summer's coming. I know we're only 2 days on the back end of Christmas and we haven't closed the books on 2018 yet, but folks, time flies. Like a goose flying south to get its freak on, time flies, I'm here to tell you. So what better time to come into Big Ed Barnum's Bobble Barn and Garden and get yourself some ceramic demi-humans. I'm talking gnomes, lawn jockeys, gargoyles, I got some concrete cherubs, and they're hardworking folks. And we got them all at Big Ed Barnum's Bobble Barn and Garden for 15% off. And I know what you're going to say, Big Ed Barnum. Every time I see a garden gnome or a lawn jockey, they're just standing around doing nothing. Well, they're hardworking people. They're entitled to a break as well. When you don't see them, they're raking leaves, pulling dead squirrels out of your gutters, all kinds of stuff. So folks, I'm serious about this. Summer's coming. So what better time to contemplate one of life's great mysteries? Where do Weber grills go when they die? Well, some of them make their way to Big Ed Barnum's Bobble Barn and Garden, where they get reduced, reused, recycled, repurposed into all manner of useful household items, like a giant hot air popcorn popper, a urinal for the basement, or my favorite, just a spacious conveyance to wheel your drunk neighbor home when he's worn his welcome out on your back porch. And we have all kinds of those at Big Ed Barnum's Bobble Barn and Garden at 15% off. I've said it once. I have, in fact, said it twice, but it bears repeating, folks. Summer is coming. So what better time to indulge yourself in some winged elegance? I'm talking storks, pelicans, flamingos. We have all manner of high-class, long-legged birds at Big Ed Barnum's Bobble Barn and Garden, and yes, they are 15% off. And something I like to do is I like to take about 100 pink flamingos and put them in the yard, and then I'll just take off my shirt and lie in the grass, and I'll spread my wings, and I'll pretend I've taken flight to some exotic locale, like Mazatlan or Acapulco. But folks, don't let my imagination dictate your travel plans. You can pretend to fly wherever you want to with winged birds that are 15% off. I think you know what I'm gonna say. Summer's coming. So what better time to come into Big Ed Barnum's Bobble Barn and Garden and check out the Pacific Northwest's only wind chime notification registry. Folks, we all know wind chimes let us know where the crazy people live. So when one of those loonies comes in and buys a set of wind chimes at Big Ed Barnum's Bobble Barn and Garden at 15% off, I publish their name and address so you can look them up and find out where they're living. Now, a friend of mine said the wind chimes should be an indication of where they're living, and that's true. But with a notification registry, you can plot a map, and you can take action. Whatever that action is your business and the business of the members of your neighborhood watch. But don't tell me. I don't want to get entangled in any business you might have going on with that. Now, when Stacey said I could be on the show, I would say when Stacey booked me, but she didn't book me. I begged and pleaded for her to be on the show. And she said, that's fine. But Big Ed, you can't just stand up there and try and sell people resplendent yard objects at sensible prices and a generous discount. You've got... She said, you've got to entertain people. And I said, Stacey, I'm a businessman. I don't know how to do that. And she said, well, I mean, you can do all kinds of stuff. Just, you know, recite a poem. I mean, she said, you know, even people who hate poetry usually have a poem that they can recite. And I said, hickory dickory dock. And she said, Big Ed, I'm going to stop you right there. And I said, see, it's hard. Entertaining people is not something I do. And she said, well, you love to talk. Why don't you tell a story? So I sat her down, and I told the story of being administered a personality test in the parking lot of a truck stop while I was waiting for a turkey pot pie to cook. At the truck stop, they cook them from frozen, so it takes like 45 minutes. And when this fella came up and said, would you like to take a personality test? I said, hell, I ain't got nothing else to do. And the results of that personality test led me to lose 12 to 15 years of my life in a religious cult. And Stacey said, maybe don't tell that story. And I said, okay. So I looked Stacey in the eye, and I said, I can't sing. And she looked at me in the eye and said, that's the most honest, truthful thing anybody's ever said to me. And I said, well, that's the most depressing thing anybody's ever said to me. And then it was like just a long, awkward afternoon of trying to figure out how I was going to entertain some of you folks. And she said, well, just tell a joke. And then I had an idea that I would tell the first joke that I ever wrote and told on this very stage almost 10 years ago, but we'll round up we'll round up 10 years. I think I was standing over there when I told this, but. The directions on a box of Imodium say, take 2 Imodium at the first sign of diarrhea. The directions should say, take 2 Imodium at the first sign that says half-priced ceviche. I'm Big Ed Barnum, thank you very much.
Scott laid down most of the floor right about where you guys are, hands and knees, did it all. I also forgot to mention that when we first opened, there was no way up to the mezzanine. We hadn't put the stairs in yet, and there's a pull-down ladder in the green room, but that wasn't there yet. And our first tech was Ashley Smith, who doesn't really do tech, but does now. And we had an extension ladder, and she'd climb up the ladder, and then we'd take the ladder away and do the show. And then after the show, everyone would be hanging out, and Ashley would come over and be like, can somebody please let me down? That's the kind of love I'm talking about, you guys. All right, without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Whiskey Tango!
Started at all. We just want to take a moment. She's probably not going to like this, but the whole reason that anybody else, any of us are here is because of Stacey Hallal. So if you would help me to make sure that she feels nice and warm and welcome, this is a celebration of her as much as it is the theater. So 1, 2, 3. Thanks, everybody. All right, we're Whiskey Tango. All we need to get started is a word you really like to say out loud.
Damn.
Damn? Damn. I heard damn.
I heard tunnel as well.
What about that
that's
damn
really,
tunnel?
That's really great, because like one says, don't come here, and the other one's like, please
come on
go. All right. Damn and tunnel. Thank you very much. We're Whiskey Tango. Next, please. Yeah, we need to see your ID. Reason for being in the great state of Connecticut?
Because I just want to be free.
Thank you, Thomas. I want to be free, too. You're welcome to pass.
Thanks.
Next, please.
Connecticut.
ID, please. Reason for being in Connecticut?
I feel like I can't beat the first guy. I heard you guys have like nice like birdhouses and shit, but like I don't want to be here anymore. Like that was way awesome.
I'm sorry, Frank. State of Connecticut is going to deny you entrance.
That's fine. I'll try again next.
Okay. Next, please. Identification?
Yes, there you are.
Okay. Reason for being in the great state of Connecticut? Why do you have a piece of paper there, sir? Those are your notes?
I am in the great state of Connecticut.
You're not actually in this great state of Connecticut yet, sir. Oh.
I am at the great border of the state of Connecticut.
Carry on.
And I would like entry for syrup.
Hey, dude, if you want to ever get out of Rhode Island.
Hey, listen to
don't
me.
Don't say listen, it. Don't
listen to me. Do you want to get out of Rhode Island?
Of course I want to get out of Rhode Island. You know I want to get out of Rhode Island.
All right. All you need to do is talk about maple trees.
I get real nervous about foliage. You know I do.
What? What's there to worry about? They've got trees in the spring and summer and they don't in the fall and winter.
That's so much to remember!
It's a lot to remember. I get it. But look, you're too big for Rhode Island.
Everything is too big for Rhode Island.
You're too big for Rhode Island.
Hey, you're getting too close to Maine, all right? Back up.
Sorry.
You're too big for this.
I am too big for this.
I mean, we got islands and provinces, but that's not for you.
I don't even get what a province is. Isn't that Canadian?
No, it's just the mainland, all right? So I need you to do one thing. I need you to get to Vermont for me.
Like, I get why I want to leave Rhode Island, because I'm...
Get to Vermont for me!
I'm so big.
Look.
But why do you... Why are you so invested is where my fear comes. I'm sorry.
It's the seawall. Look, I had a chance. I had a chance to get out of here.
Well, why don't we go together?
No, I can't go. I belong here now.
Why don't we talk about the trees together? We can talk about the firs.
Oh, like you're gonna get into Rhode Island. Out of Rhode Island.
Isn't in out here? It's so small.
I don't even know.
It's so small.
You can do this by yourself. You can't do this with me.
Hey, listen, you're getting too close to New York City. I need you to back up just a little bit.
Sorry.
Everywhere I go, they tell me to back up. You transcend boundaries, son.
When I get to Connecticut, I'm gonna send for you.
Don't send for
no,
me.
No, you're gonna-
I'll be dead!
I can't do it alone.
Son! You gotta do this. If you wanna live past 42, you gotta leave this godforsaken state. Go on, get out of here. Your mother and I never loved you.
No.
That's why she died in childbirth. Go on, get out of here.
All by myself. Didn't want to be all by myself anymore. Well, it's my 42nd birthday. Wish I could have celebrated it with the family that I love. Fucking Delaware and their liberal gun laws.
We got a problem. You want to start or you want me to start? You want me to start? It's a stupid question. You see the news? It's on the TV tubes. Every day. It's part of the bottom that tells you what's going on. There's pictures up above. It tells you what it is. You watch those spots? Really? You want me to keep going? There's multiple news channels. Some of them say one thing, some of them say another thing. Amazingly enough, they both say the same things about yous. Hey, am I boring you? It's on all the news channels. Name a news channels. Yeah, you're on that one.
Professor Phillips, we hired you to be a current events teacher, okay? Those kids are dying in there. Your attitude is sardonic.
I mean, have you seen the news channels?
Yes, I've told you this before. I know your lessons. It's literally just describing what news is. Like, as a concept.
There's a man and or a woman. Oftentimes behind a desk, sometimes where there's wind. And they describe what is going on around them.
This is the problem, though, is that no one's learning any of the current events because that you just surmise what it looks like.
Sometimes there's a graphic,
God
often misspelled.
What do you mean often?
Often? Sometimes?
No, not the word.
What?
Are graphics frequently misspelled in the news?
Sometimes. I don't know. I only watch 4 to 6 minutes. 3 minutes of that had an off spelling of my graphic. Graphic.
What?
Graphic.
Omographic?
Omographic. Had a misspelling of omographic.
Spell omographic. That's not a letter. Stop.
Listen, Dean, I don't mean to point out the obvious. I have tenure. You cannot fire me.
I know you have tenure, okay?
Tenure, which means I could be here for tenure or more.
I know we gave you tenure, okay? But it doesn't mean I can't reassign you to a different class if you don't
shake. What?
Yeah, that was part of the tenure.
You want me to teach something about graphics? I can teach you about graphics. I know all about them.
Can you spell graphics?
That's
not a letter!
That is a first letter of graphics. Listen, Dean.
Listen, you make sounds really well. What if we moved you to, like, music or something?
Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch. That part makes sense. Terrence, I just wanted to thank you personally for coming to my intro to cello class. Doesn't look like anybody else wanted to show up.
Hey, it's absolutely an honor to be able to take a cello class here at New Jersey State University.
You know, I agree. Every couple of years, I think to myself, I should really teach more.
You really should.
Yeah, I know, but I got into this gig because of the research.
Research?
Research. Thomas? I think you're going places.
Me?
You.
Me.
Honest.
I've never been any place in my life.
That's not true, Thomas.
It's absolutely true.
No.
It's 100% true.
Scientifically proven you have been to one place.
Right here.
Yeah?
Right here. This used to be the midwifery program.
What?
You taught zero music.
That's not true. That's not true. I sang Amazing Grace.
Why are there a group of students outside wanting to start the midwifery program back?
What?
What is going on out there?
The midwifery program?
Don't spell it, don't.
It's bad.
No, I didn't.
First letter,
Have you suffered a brain injury? It's okay if you have. We have like a CT scan here on campus.
Really?
It might explain a whole lot.
Can I take a ride in the CT scan?
Absolutely.
I told you you were going places, Thomas.
I didn't really think about it.
I said it. I said it the first time I saw you, I was like, he looks like he knows cello, but he also looks like he knows how to run a high quality diagnostic piece of equipment.
The thing is that they make these things so easy to use these days.
It's like pushing the button. It's like starting a Subaru.
It's just like that. All right. Make sure you don't straighten your legs when you're going through, all right?
Why? Don't worry about what could possibly go wrong if I straighten my leg? Oh, my goodness. It is darker in here than I expected. I like the sound of this machine. Thomas, I don't mean to. I'm sorry.
I'll be right there!
Thomas, did that say air? Air. I heard air.
Evacuate facility. Evacuate.
Thomas. Thomas.
Yeah.
Thomas, why is it getting warm on my back?
There's a fire inside of the chamber, but you know, it's normal. We've got procedures.
Core temperature rising.
What? Why is there even a concept of core temperature?
Eject, oh my eject goodness. The warp core. Eject the warp core.
Wait a second. Why is there a warp core? I didn't even straighten my legs. Oh, God, Thomas. Thomas, tell the great state of New Jersey that I love her. No, no, Thomas. God damn it.
So I hear you're looking for papers.
I mean, yeah, I'm into papers. What you got?
I can get you across state lines.
Connecticut?
There's a lot of people with big ears around here.
From Delaware?
Yeah. They're always pointing guns, you know? Mm. Yeah, listen.
What?
Nothing, Jeff.
It's cool. Good job. If you don't move, they kind of just forget you're there.
Yeah. Like a Tyrannosaurus Rex.
Exactly. Anyway, I got these. They look roughly like you, but you're going to have to, like, do that thing with your mouth. Exactly. Yeah. If you do that at the border, that should get you an okay, all right?
Now, what if I was looking to bring someone else with me?
You fucking nuts. Like under your jacket or something?
No, I want to send back for my paw, my ma.
Look, these are hard enough to get. I can't necessarily scramble a second one. But I did.
I like the coy way you do business.
I like to get your hopes down and then bring them back up.
Okay.
All right. But listen, you can't tell anybody I gave this to. Shh.
Well, that.
Jeff, it's just some baby in Maine. It's okay.
All right.
They're still allowed to have babies in Maine. Okay, remember, do the thing with your mouth, and then your grandpappy has to do the face with the thing with his ears.
He's just my pappy. He's not a grandpappy. I mean, he is a grandpappy, but he's not.
Okay.
Next plate. Identification.
I am born and raised in Connecticut. Go Bernie.
Right? Am I right? All right. You got two IDs here. Where's the second? This big-eared fellow with you?
Pop?
I ain't got more than a couple minutes left in me.
I sent back for you, Pa.
I know.
I told you I would.
I had a casket picked out and everything. Just get me across the state line.
You gotta do a weird thing with your lips.
Welcome to Connecticut.
Look at it, Papa. Isn't it beautiful? Papa, look at it. Papa, it's Connecticut. We made it. It's the closest we're ever gonna have real health care in America. Someone get this man a doctor. It's actually affordable.
Did someone call an affordable doctor?
I did.
All right, I'll do this for a coupon.
Oh, nice. I also have a Groupon, if that works as well.
It does. We take everything. We take Groupons for other places.
Nice. Yeah. I love this place.
He's dead.
Well, Papa, you made it.
He did? No, he didn't make it. I don't think you understand, son. He's gone.
You really just made the grieving process a lot harder.
That's what we do here.
Thanks, doctor.
Yeah. I'm gonna just linger here for a bit if that's okay. I got nowhere to be.
I would prefer to mourn my father alone, but if you want to be here.
You're gonna be pushy about it. Wait, there is one thing we could do. There is a CT machine in New Jersey State University. I don't know what the hell it does, but I've seen people like act weird in it. I bet if we put him inside, something will happen.
If you don't think it's too late.
Let's find out.
Let's do it.
Let's do it.
Just be strong, Papa. Just be strong. Or, I mean, I guess he can't be strong, really. Just do what you're doing, Dad.
Moisten his forehead. All right, cool. All right, come on.
Boy loves ya!
Wait.
Hey, Dad, I've been here before. It's gonna feel like this is the end, but it's not the end. Well, for me, it was the end, but for you, it's the beginning. Okay, you listening? No, you can't get out. Well, I couldn't get out. You will probably get out. Listen, there's gonna be some pearly gates. You're gonna think to yourself, oh my goodness, this is gonna be amazing, but that boy loves you. And you turn around, head on back.
He's moving. He has some brain function that seems.
Yeah, that spit on your forehead.
Fight, Papa, fight!
That spit on your forehead. Listen, that spit was put on there by a boy that loves you. You hear me? The boy loves you.
There's a lot of muscles, they're activating.
That's how he used to sleep. He always thrashed.
People think this is a CT scan, but it's basically just a collection of random wires and a cello.
Is that a heartbeat, Doctor?
Yeah, that's a heartbeat.
You know, right? Oh my God, I think he's back.
Hey.
But he's trapped.
Tell your boy I love him.
Papa, don't panic. Papa.
No, no, no. It's the real world.
It's me. We're in New Jersey, Pa. It's not quite Connecticut, but we could just get over to New York with a ferry. Yeah, Papa. It's me. It's me, Papa.
This is some shit. You look just like me, Jive Turkey.
Oh, no.
Oh, damn.
Papa?
Oh, we gonna go out and hit Studio 76, huh?
Papa?
Let's do this shit. Yeah. Me and you, we gonna get blown, son.
This isn't
him. Oh, that's right. Oh, we gonna pick up so many hoes. I hope I make a child tonight. Don't
think. This isn't my
ear.
This isn't how my dad used to act.
What? Jeremiah Detroit Slim. What you know?
It's Jeremy.
Oh, shit. This motherfucker's calling me Jeremy. Call me by my baptism name. Son?
Where the hell did he get that?
I feel like the magnet and the machine would have taken care
right?
of it.
Right?
The magnet and the machine.
Oh.
Oh my God, it's a 3D printed gun.
You're getting all scientific on me right now. All right, I see how this is.
Dean, the Board of Regents has recently reviewed your experience and has realized that a man came back from the dead in your CT scan, carrying what can only be described as an improvised firearm. I'm sorry. I hate to do this.
Please don't.
But the Board of Regents has decided to relieve you of your duties and send you to Rhode Island.
No!
After I just acknowledge a few more people, board members are our secret workers on in a place like this. And one's here, Betsy Green, who's not currently on our board, was an early board member and has been part of Curious since before we had a false start Curious. And Betsy was on that board and then came back and has been awesome. Robin Johnson has been on the board from the beginning. And Karen Wanke, who is our accountant, came to a New Year's show, and then afterwards she was just, I had never met her, and I was all excited because I had just gotten our books in order. I was like, we're finally in a position where we could get grants and like get audited and stuff. And she's like, you probably shouldn't say that to me. But then came in and not only like handle our books and our taxes and stuff, but she works with all of the big nonprofits in town and does their books and is on their boards. And so when things were happening that were scary or weird or hard, she would always be like, no, that's normal for this point in a company's development. And so that was a relief because I was like, oh, good, it's not just me. And then Knut Snortum is not here tonight, but let's give Knut a round of applause. He's been playing keyboards here in the dark for 10 years. He accompanies Showdown and Pipes and a whole bunch of stuff, and he's so talented, as well as Johan, and now we have a whole bunch of new musical crew. Staff members, I just want to acknowledge Leslie Smolik, Sarah Shoemaker, Chase Padgett, Carla Kakowski, DK Reinemer, and Cameron Gable. And this is sort of this last couple years. By round of applause, how many people have been to Curious before the remodel? Who's seen it? Yeah. The rest of you have no idea. Anthony's just gonna play a very short little time lapse of the final stages of our remodel. Just have a quick look. So this was our old stage coming down. It was just a little stage right here in this corner. We took it apart, and then we built a temporary stage, and then in one day, we moved it over. And this was all happening while we were renting the theater out, so we'd have to clean everything up and make it look good, and then fit all these projects in between, because getting a construction person to do a small job in Portland right now is next to impossible. They don't even want to give you a bid because they're all working on big projects. And so that's the new stage going in. So we turned everything around. We put the stairs up. We built the room up there. And not only did we remodel the space, but we got a grant from the Mount Hood Cable Regulatory Commission for all this tech equipment that you guys see here. It was a $175,000 grant. Anthony, who's up there right now, helped hang all these lights. Let's give Anthony a round of applause. And so all this fanciness came from them, which then created a need for tech. And Dan Humke, who we just celebrated because he's moving away, and he just got back from Japan, but let's give him a round of applause. He's been running all the tech and doing everything. And before that, as I mentioned, there was just the pull-down attic in the green room. So I want to acknowledge Ken Wells and Joe Pierce. Joe Pierce is here. They had to climb up that rickety thing, and it was just a table up there with storage and just the shittiest tech in the world. So let's give Ken Wells and Joe Pierce an acknowledgement for making shit work when our tech was iffy. But I need to take an extra moment to acknowledge Mr. Casey Jones. Are you still here, Casey?
Yes.
Yeah. Casey Jones helped with our electrical. He helped build this stage. He's traveled with me and done tech for me. And I'm just going to tell this one story. Like, you can't have a place like this without a Casey Jones. He's built that rail up there. He built the railing up the stairs. Like, whenever we need something, he's fixed the dishwasher. Like, Casey does everything. And so when the time lapse kind of skips to the truss being there because that day was so insane we couldn't keep up with it. So this truss is 12 feet high, and we had a 17-foot ladder on that side, and we had the scissor lift on this side. Me and Chase were on this side. We had to be on separate sides of the scissor lift so because it was so heavy to balance it out. And then little Leslie and Sarah were on the ladder in the middle bringing this truss up, and Casey was by himself on the 17-foot ladder carrying the truss all the way up to the top. In the middle, they only got so far, right? And then it was beyond their reach, so they were no longer supporting it. And Chase, you know, was on a scissor lift, so, like, he pulls it up and he puts it on. He's like, I'm in. And Casey's like, I don't know. And we're like, just drop it, Casey, just drop it. And like in a movie, when the bad guy is about to fall off a skyscraper and the good guy catches them by their arm and they have the choice to let the person fall and die or they can save them and they go and they pull the person up. Casey Jones, who had been jackhammering the concrete the whole day before, so his body's a wreck, Casey just goes, I got it. And we were all like, what the fuck did you just do? So, superhuman, Casey Jones. Let's give Casey a round of applause. Immediately followed by him finishing the connection from the ramp to the stage for the rental we had that evening. It was insane. All right, I think that, and I did just want to acknowledge my parents for all that they've given, all the support that they've given, and Colin Mockery. Who if I don't know if you guys know, he comes here once a year and does a show way below like what he should get paid. And it's basically a donation to the theater, and it's a huge gift to us. So Colin Mockery. But now we've got everybody back in town, people from town, people visiting back, and I love that there's like a crew of people who all live in New York now and in LA, and they still help each other and work together. And I'm so excited, including my two comedy sons. Jason and Alex. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Curious Comedy Reunion Players! Jenn Hunter, Craig McCarthy, Alex Gavlick, Jason Nguyen, Gabe Deere, Nate Smith, Jake Michaels, Garrett Palm, Katie Behrens, Katie Michaels, Nathan Loveless, and Leon Anderson. And I'm gonna get to play in this as well. So what we're gonna do is just kind of a Armando style. We're gonna do improv based on stories, and in honor of today, I've asked people to think about if they have a story that's related to Curious, which may cause an implosion if we're doing improv in Curious about Curious, so I'm hoping it'll work out. I think we'll be able to handle it. So, ladies and gentlemen, our reunion show.
Okay, I think I have the winning story.
Because improv is about winning, Katie.
It is.
I've taught you nothing else.
So, we do a big New Year's show here every year, as some of you may know. And the first year we did it was quite a year. So, I, just a little background for me, I grew up really like kind of sheltered in a conservative household. I even went to a conservative Christian college. So when I moved here to Portland, that's when I learned how to drink the hard way. and so that's just a little bit of background about me. So this New Year's, I started drinking before, like, we even had the doors open to let people in. Like, we were still decorating, and somebody brought me a coffee with Bailey's in it. I don't even know if Stacey knew that part. So the show happened, drinking throughout the whole show, drinking after the show. It got wild. I have friends, a couple of them are here in the audience tonight, who showed up. They were also a little out of control. And I was so drunk, I couldn't make up my mind whether or not to go home with them, and so they just left me here, but I took it as, like, they left me here. And so I just started crying, I was sobbing. Stacey could actually maybe tell the story better because she actually knows what happened.
Just did the impression.
I just have blips of it, but...
First open bar. It was in the last open bar.
Until tonight!
And it went like this. Katie goes, I just want to go home. And she starts throwing up. So we put a trash can next to her, and she's just going, I just want to go home.
Which I could have gone home. I could have gone home had I just gone with my friends who offered me a ride home, which I took as a slight.
But then I had to drive her home.
Yeah, which I lived in Selwood, and Stacey and Bob lived around the corner. So they had to drive to the other side of town to bring me home while I had a bowl in my lap.
A silver mixing bowl.
A silver mixing bowl, probably still used here.
The truth is, probably, yeah.
We're a non-profit.
There's yellow envelopes to make donations.
And I was just crying and saying how much I wanted to go home the whole trip. And the next day, I was so embarrassed, but I took a deep breath and I called Stacey to apologize. She's like, did you learn a lesson? It's like, what I remember, that may not have been what she said. But there's been a lot of moments in Stacey and I's 10-year close friendship where she's been like, did you learn a lesson?
Usually not. That's the thing, though.
I don't. And I apologized, and she was like, just come for the show today. Everything's fine. Just don't do it again. Which is a testament to Stacey's grace. Just apologize when you fuck up, and she'll hear you out. So happy New Year's, everybody.
All right, Mitchell Conway, today you are gonna learn to drive the hard way.
Dad,
Shut up!
Earlier today, you said I was gonna learn to drink the hard way.
That's part of the hard way, all right? Don't talk back. Put your hands on the wheel. 10-2. There you go. That's how you do it.
Dad, we're still in park.
Are we there yet? Are we there yet?
I won't borrow the car anymore, I'm sorry.
Exactly. And return your mother's bowls.
Mom, you don't want those bowls back.
some fun dip. Just a packet of fun dip.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
It's got cocaine in it. Have a good party. Enjoy.
Dad.
The stick is made of cocaine, too. Thanks, Dad.
Yeah.
The package is hemp.
you're the best dad ever.
I mean, it's cool that you're using hemp. It's, it's like reusable. Not reusable. What's the word I'm looking for?
Sustainable!
Your parents are absolutely just gems. Wow, I remember
when they
moved into the neighborhood. Oh man, they painted their door red. Paint a door red.
That's wild to you?
That's the wild thing
about the wild part of
my parents?
Oh my goodness. And then I remember the first board meeting. They were just out of control.
Is that oxycodone?
Yeah.
Am I left? I am right.
You need a ride?
I am right.
I need a ride.
You need a ride too?
I need a ride too.
Why you need a ride too?
I need a ride to home.
Me too.
Whoa. We need a ride to the same place, but have you ever thought of that our same place is different?
You know what's weird is if you say something like that, you make a black hole. Do you guys want to come home?
Yeah, we want to go home.
This is home.
I told you I was going to teach you how to die.
I feel like we're out of here.
I told you I was going to teach you how to die.
Come home.
I need to edit the scene because you two can't even pretend to be drunk driving. Those are my comedy children.
Well, actually, we'll tell a story, actually.
We have been railing coke here for years. Yeah.
Jason and I went to the same high school together.
You did?
And it was an art school in Vancouver,
and
Washington.
And academics.
Very good point. And we were theater nerds. We were in Alice in Wonderland together.
Alice in concert.
Oh yeah,
it was a musical.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I remember I got cast as an information card, like in the deck of cards.
That's cool. I got cast as a pig.
Right on. Yeah. So we were very unsatisfied with our theater careers.
Right.
So we came one night to Curious Comedy for an open mic. It was our first time coming here. My mom drove both of us.
What's hilarious about that is Alex had been building it up, you know, leading it up. He's like, after rehearsal, my mom's going to drive both of us to an open mic, okay?
I got the hookup.
And I
go with my mom.
And I immediately called my parents to lie to them. I'm gonna be at rehearsal for very long. Very long.
Yeah.
And I didn't tell my parents, we went to this open mic.
Yeah, so we go to this this open mic. It was every other Sunday. Virginia Jones ran it. It was amazing for years and years and years. And I remember two things from that open mic that night. We got ruthlessly made fun of by
a like a gang of comedians.
Yeah.
Right? They're all standing here right now.
And the other thing I remember from that night is that Stacey came directly over to us and like saw that we were kids trying to do stand-up
just little
at
babies.
Her theater. And took the
How
time
old
to
were
say,
you?
I was 15.
I was 16, so I was older and cool.
So, it's true. And so I just remember her coming by and saying, like, hey, first of all, don't stop doing this. Come back anytime.
Right.
And second, make sure you move the mic stand behind you when you talk.
All the time.
I learned from Gabe.
that's how we came in. Yeah.
I think you're going to love it here. It is an art school.
Oh.
And academics. We do have to say that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. But I saw in there there's no math classes I'll have to take.
Well, we do have a creative math class.
So no math.
No, we have an artistic.
Welcome to math class. 2 + 3 is orange.
And I am orange.
She's my lover. And my muse.
And we are math.
I'm 7 years old and I love this.
Now we're going to talk about division.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Because orange isn't always
orange.
There's something going on in my body right now.
Why do you want to paint our bedroom orange?
I don't. When I was a child, something happened, and now it's the only way I can get it out. Honey, please do this for me.
You're so angry. It seems aggressive.
It's just confusing for me. That's the only emotion.
The only color that you can get it up to?
I tried sienna once, and that didn't even work. Specific navel orange, and that's the only thing I can do it.
I don't know how you can hit my car. How do you miss an orange Kia? What are you doing? What are you doing?
So
I want your information.
I don't know what I'm doing.
I want your insurance information.
I'll give you my number.
Taking the microphone stand out of it yet.
It's so adorable!
It's me, your mother! You're doing great! I'm in the car out front!
Thanks, Mom!
Get a speech pathologist.
Why? Right. I'm just many.
I don't want to do math at a comedy show!
You're stealing my bit!
My bit, I learned it by myself.
I want to see that other guy do this bit.
No, he's not as good as me. He's not as good as me.
Just get that kid a Bailey's.
Hey, good set, man. Yeah, you could really got it cut out to be a stand-up.
I don't know. I feel like I phoned it in.
Yeah.
It was inauthentic, and I don't know.
Let me give you some advice.
Can I check it?
I'll tell you something right here. Look, I invited you out of this milk bar for one reason only. I'm the stand-up around here, okay? I'm the best, okay?
Do you have any notes?
Put the mic stand behind you and get the fuck out of town, dude. That's right. I'm the best at stand-up.
I don't know.
Hey, I'm a producer from America's Got Talent.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, here you go. You are way too old.
See you around, kid. I'll see you around.
Hey, Jeremy.
I was waiting outside the school for 5 hours for you. Where were you? You said you had art practice.
I'm Jeremy's manager.
Sorry, Mom, you're gonna have to talk to Dylan.
Dylan.
Dylan?
D-A-R-R-E-N, but Dylan. Right? Hey, I'm sorry. Go ahead, talk to me.
No, talk to my son. He's a six-year-old boy. He's the love of my life. I've been waiting outside this elementary school for...
He's a six-year-old boy and you still give him bottles? Is that a normal age? I don't have kids.
It's about... I don't know anything.
I know. Dewin. Yes.
Feels weird saying it. Dewin, right? Yes. What are you managing my son for? I'm four. America's got what?
Talent. And your kid has talent. I don't know where he got it from. Oh, God, that's mean. I'm sorry.
Dewin.
Yes. Look, do you have a script for him? Do you have a project for him to work on? A creative project, not cleaning his room again?
Mom, I'm open to ideas.
We talked about doing that play about animals meeting at the zoo.
Oh, okay.
For all your kids out back, you know.
What do you think?
It's not edgy enough.
It doesn't sound edgy. That's not funny. That's not good. We need something edgy.
You know, I thought Jeremy was so funny, but now he's like, it's all dark and weird.
That shit sells these days.
I just wanted some good laughs.
What do you want to laugh about?
I want to laugh about, like, little kid things, you know? I just want him to have that cute little speech impediment I can giggle, you know?
It's a six-year-old kid who should be trying to find his way in the world.
Yeah, but now he's in this, like...
He's in this play.
Yeah.
And clearly, you're trying to make a comedy out of a tragedy. This kid should probably be learning how to say his ABCs and add one and three together to get to four, but... You got him up there.
One and three make yellow. Everybody knows that.
Jesus Christ.
I'm going to tell a story. It took place on April 9th, 2016. And I looked at the set list and I was like, oh, there's two visiting people in the Curious Comedy Showdown. And I got to the green room and I was like, oh, it's two British people. Great, we'll just do British improv for the entire evening. So I was talking to Amar and Mark, and I have a British nanny, and so I was like, oh, you know, my grandmother lived in London, and one of them, not both of them, but one of them really tuned in, and I was like, God, this guy is good at listening, and I don't even know what I'm saying anymore. And I was thinking about thinking, and I liked him so much. And then the show started, and apparently British people can't stay on a stage. Because during the first part of the show, Amar fell off the side of the stage. So right about over here, he just fell off and was down. And then in the second half, Mark also fell off of the stage. And I was in the middle of starting a song, and Tyler was like, and she sings a song that she sang in the beginning, but now in a sad tone. And I talked about that I was going to be an engineer that knew how to keep British people on stage. So I went home, and Amar immediately Facebook friended me, and I was like, ah, but I wanted to talk to the other one. So I really did a lot of Facebook stalking to find Mark, and so I friended him, and some months went by, I'm just like, you know, chit-chat, like. And I was like, if I like everything that he posts, I'll get in his head, and he'll, like, he'll keep seeing my name, and I'll, that's the ticket. And he was back in London, and one day I was like, oh,
fuck it, whatever. So I said, I have a massive crush on you. And he was like, well, I'm British, I don't know how to deal with compliments. And I said, well, you're 5,000 miles away, so what could possibly come of it? And fast forward a couple months, and I was like, you should just come back and live with me for a 90-day visa. And he did. And I called my mom, and I was like, holy shit, a man's coming to live with me for a whole summer. And she's like, what? You need a new bed, you need new bras, you need everything. So I upgraded my entire condo and wardrobe immediately. And at the end of that 90 days, Mark and I were engaged, and we had our wedding over in the UK with him and all of his improviser friends. And my whole wedding party was improvisers from Curious Comedy Theater. And we came back and we had our entire wedding reception here on this stage. Yay. So, love happens, yay improv!
You're gonna do it yourself this time.
That's him.
I understand you don't want to, but I don't care about that. You're gonna do it anyway.
Please don't make me.
I'm your British nanny. That's what we do. Just keep moving at this pace and you'll never do it anyway.
That was the idea.
If you just try hard enough, you can leave the carpet onto the hardwood floor.
Give me a boost, just another.
You're thinking about this a little too much. Please tell me, what's the worst that could happen once you take the step off the carpet onto the hardwood floor?
Well, I could fall. I could crack my head.
Hey, Jen. I'm a little worried about the liability issues.
Yeah.
When the Brits fell off the stage,
because yeah,
we
too.
Couldn't afford to finish it.
We should move the stage and make it bigger.
Well, that's a pipe dream. Okay. Would you mind kind of going online, flirting with him a little bit? Making him think that you love him, maybe marry him? Because I can't afford a lawsuit.
Yeah.
I know I ask a lot of you.
No, it's fine. But, like, how long is the marriage gonna, like, how long is it gonna
I don't know, maybe do a little thing over there, a little thing over here. Make him uproot his whole life, move over here.
I'll buy a house for him.
Wow, so you want to move me to America?
International phone call real quick.
I'm so flattered.
I just need
you to. If I'm going to be honest, my big concern is my medical costs.
Right. Yes.
Right.
Yes.
They're quite massive.
Well, I can get you on my insurance. I'm not from Connecticut, but still good insurance.
Nanny. In Britain, they have nannies for much longer.
Just not bartenders in the US.
We do that too.
Okay, all right.
It's just when you lose the use of your legs, you know.
I'm her nanny.
And they're all coming with you.
Well, I mean, I don't know how I could take care of myself without them.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the wedding. Jen, Mark. As an improvised wedding, before we get started, I'm gonna need a suggestion from the audience. Any word you want.
Starfish.
Starfish, fantastic. Love is like a starfish.
Oh, sorry, we're late.
7:30 to midnight, and then noon to midnight, all day Saturday, all live streamed. We're just trying to get 1,000 people to donate $10. So maybe you can help. So that we can go into the next 10 years. Ten for ten years. I think that's all. I just love every one of you guys so much, and I appreciate
you.
And I don't know all of you, so I'm not gonna tell you I love you.
But she probably does.
But I probably do. That's probably the truth. But I just want to thank you all again. Did you guys have fun?